Praise the Lord, church. Thank you for joining us here this Sunday morning. God's been moving in ways that, well, I'll say they're unusual. We've certainly had to take steps in faith like we haven't had to take steps in faith before. But my God is in control. Would you pray with me right now that God would bless this time as we enter this time of worship? Jesus, we're here for you. We're here because of you. We're here because you extended an invitation. Lord, and this morning we accept. We thank you for the invitation, and we want to worship you. We want to bring you praise. We want to produce something that smells sweet. Songs, through our hands being lifted, through our hearts being open to you, Jesus. We ask it all in your precious name, Lord, that you would bless this time, that you would manifest your presence, and no matter where your body is at this moment, where the children of God are, wherever they are, God, that you would make yourself known in that place. We ask it in your name, Jesus. Amen.
You are welcome here. Thank you.
I'd like our worship team to sing a special for us.
Well, praise the Lord this morning. The Bible declares that our God is the giver of every good and perfect gift. And this morning we have a reason to rejoice, because he has given us so much peace and so much hope. Even in trying times, he has given us a security, a hope, and a future that is sure, that's going to work out for our good. And so this morning, I just pray that we would rejoice together from our homes, that we would declare to our God, you are the giver of all good things. Every blessing in my life, God, you give me joy unspeakable. Can we sing a song of thanksgiving unto our God this morning?
This is what it feels like to be loved by you, loved by you. This is what it feels like to love you more and more each day. This is what it feels like to be loved by you, loved by you. This is what it feels like to be loved by you, loved by you.
musicians, our music ministry. I'm so grateful for it. I don't know, how many weeks has it been now? I don't even want to count. It feels like a lifetime already. You know, I want you to know that Pastor and I do not have service like we normally do without heavy contemplation. It's not an easy decision. There's a strong desire to open up these doors, to never shut them. And we've experienced a few seasons, haven't we? You know, first because we had no choice, and second because caution turned into concern, as you know, many families within our congregation have been directly impacted by this virus. We may even be approaching some level of herd immunity now, having been 6 weeks ago, I think, that we had our last in-person service. You know, God has given us, the Bible says, not the spirit of fear, but of a sound mind. And we know that we're to walk by faith and not by sight. But it can't be one or the other. It's not just faith, and it's not just, you know, what we can see and what we can understand and exercising some common sense. It's both faith and sound judgment. And we take responsibility not just for your spiritual well-being, but for your health and safety. And so as we have been contemplating, and literally week to week, sometimes day to day, you know, we know that there's still a situation going on all around us. But as we look forward, as we plan ahead, you can put on your calendars next Sunday, November 29th, as when we're going to start in-person services again. We'll be resuming our regular service schedule starting next Sunday, the Sunday after Thanksgiving. But we understand that there may be some circumstances where you need to shelter at home. And for that reason, we're going to continue to offer the full services online like we have been. The services will be available shortly after our regular service schedule. So if Sunday morning starts at 10 a.m., you can expect to find Sunday morning service somewhere shortly thereafter around noon. Same for Sunday night, same for Wednesday night. Of course, Saturday morning will only be in person, but as we reopen the doors, as we gather together, for some it may be too soon, and for others it may not be soon enough. But if you choose to participate in person, if you choose to be here, we're grateful for that. But we would ask that everyone, if they're here in person, would wear a mask. Now, masks are not a guarantee of safety, but they do appear to be a reasonable measure of precaution, reducing risk. I can't guarantee your safety, but I can't guarantee my safety when I go to Menards either, or the grocery store, and I don't stop those activities. But when we're here, when we gather together, we're going to require everyone. So regardless of your health condition, regardless of whether you've already had it or not, we need everyone to wear a mask. And maybe it's not for your sake, but for the sake of others. And when we say wear a mask, it's one that covers the nose and the mouth, that, you know, fits snugly to the face. And the only exception will be on the platform, and you may have noticed we've already taken our praise team and spread them out further. Now we take up the whole platform. So we are taking some additional precautions in that sense. And again, we don't want to put anyone in a place where they feel they don't have a choice. It is your choice to participate in person or online. And we'll continue to offer those services online, you know, going forward indefinitely, with the full worship and the preaching like we have the last two Sundays. This will be the third. If you have any questions, if you have any concerns, feel free to reach out to myself or Pastor. I'm looking forward to when we can gather together again next Sunday, but I'm asking you to take precaution. And so this morning, as we open up the Word of God, we sing a song oftentimes, I Know Who I Am. It's a proclamation that says, I know I'm a child of God. But sometimes our human nature likes to question that identity. Right? We know we're a child of God in our head, but sometimes we don't feel it. Or maybe we have less confidence one day than we do the other day. Sometimes our flesh tells us that we ought to be something other than what we are. Right? The world we live in is filled with social media and all these images, and you know, the camera at just the right angle with the right lighting with the right filter makes everything look different. And we think, well, I should have that. Why don't I? If you're a young person, I remember when I was in that time frame, you know, somewhere between 18 and 21, you know, there's all this weight of all of a sudden I'm not a kid anymore. I have to start being an adult and doing adult things, and there's this identity crisis that can happen, this question of who am I going to be? Who should I be? Who am I? It can be a very difficult time in life. The dictionary defines identity crisis as a period of uncertainty and confusion in which a person's sense of identity becomes insecure, typically due to a change in their expected aims or role in society. In other words, when something unexpected happens, when our plans are suddenly halted in front of us, or things or challenges present themselves in ways it causes us to reevaluate, we can start to wonder, where does this lead? Where do I go? What am I going to be or do one day? And certainly we're all made of the same flesh. We've all had similar times in life when we started to question, who are we really? There's many potential symptoms of an identity crisis or indicators that someone is maybe feeling like they've lost control, desperate to regain their footing, to feel like they have a sure path forward. One example I've seen is sometimes when somebody who's maybe in a role of authority, it could be your boss, your manager, somebody with a title or position, and when life throws them a curveball, they may exercise their responsibility to manage just a little bit more because they're trying to grab a hold of something that they feel like they can control. They overexert their authority in some cases because of the uncertainty that's happening someplace else. This is a symptom of someone who's having an identity crisis. They're not sure of their footing and their direction in life. Similarly, I've seen people in that same situation when they're uncertain about who they are in their role, and they feel like they don't have things under control. They look for something that they can be in charge of or responsible for, because that somehow feels like it counteracts the instability or the lack of control in some other area in their life, and in reality it doesn't. These are just two examples of how our human natures at times can react to uncertainty. Now, I don't want to drag us down this morning, but I don't want to avoid the elephant in the room either and just pretend like everybody's okay. And we don't sometimes even question ourselves, because we do. Let me ask you, have you looked in the mirror lately? Have you had doubts about who you are, who you're going to be? Have questions crept into your mind about your role in Christ and the body of God? And maybe you've even asked yourself, am I really even a Christian? Sometimes we lose sight of who we are and whose we are. This can especially be true in times of turmoil, and certainly we've had some turmoil as of recent. If you're having any doubts, again, I want to reassure you that we're all made of the same stuff, and we've all experienced that at times. You know, there's something about this season that we've been through and the times that we've been separated that I think God is actually trying to perhaps even uncover something that we didn't even realize was there. You know, if somehow our identity in God is tied singly to a service schedule and a place that we go to, as soon as that schedule and place isn't available to us, we lose our identity. And I know that's happened. I know there's people that are struggling because we've all been there. It's an identity crisis. I've lost my association with the thing that gives me my identity, and now I don't know who I am and what I'm supposed to do. This morning, God wants to repair your image of yourself. The Word of God wants to make a permanent impression upon you. If you turn your Bibles to our opening text in Psalms chapter 1, starting in verse 1. Psalms chapter 1, verse 1 says, "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper." This morning, the image that God would have us to see when we look in the mirror, when we open his word and see the reflection is an image of a tree. To be like a tree that can persevere the seasons that come and go. A tree that can produce something fruitful. A tree that shows signs of life despite the circumstances. The Bible says a tree that prospers. So as I read this scripture, I had to start to ask myself, why a tree, Lord? Whoa. Why are we like a tree planted by a river? You know, why does God compare us to this example? Of all the things that God created, I mean, think about it, the world's full of them. He chose a tree. A tree stands out both literally and figuratively in this sense. This fascination with trees started all the way back in the beginning in the book of Genesis. Turning to our next scripture in Genesis chapter 2, starting in verse 8. "And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden. And there he put a man whom he had formed, and out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil." All the way at the beginning, in creation, God started to paint a picture using trees. Of all the things he created, he chose the tree to represent eternal life, the tree of life. The tree of life was in the midst of the garden, the Bible says, surrounded by every pleasant type of tree, trees that bear fruit that were good to eat, the Bible says. And God gave mankind one job. It says he was to dress the garden, to care for the garden, to take care of the trees. Church, God has given us one job, to care for the garden, to take care of the tree. This symbol of eternal life, this tree of life, Jesus is that tree, and he hung on that tree to pay the price for you and me. And so it begins with a tree in Genesis, and then at the end, in the book of Revelation, it ends with a tree again. Revelation chapter 22, verse 12 says, "And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according to his work shall be. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates into the city. This tree is mentioned again in Revelation chapter 2, verse 7. It says, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. To him that overcometh, I will give to eat of that tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Do you want to make it to heaven? Do you want to eat of that tree? The Bible says, well, then you have to obey these commandments, follow the instructions to have access, to be granted access to this tree of life. As I started to ponder this question further, well, why a tree? Of the tree that's on our screen today is believed to be one of the oldest trees alive today. It's a bristlecone pine. There's a variety of species that actually can live thousands of years, and of all those species that can live thousands of years, this one in particular is noted to have lived, scientists estimate, over 5,000 years. Let's do a little math. So today, it's the year 2020. By taking the measurements of those growth rings, scientists are able to estimate. Have you ever seen one of those pictures, a slice of a tree in half and the growth rings? And then if you've seen pictures of like the redwood slice in half and you see lots of growth rings, the redwoods are actually quite a bit younger than these trees that we're pointing to. In fact, the tree we're looking at on the screen is one of these ancient trees. It's got 5,000 of those little growth rings. And so if the year is 2020, that means that this bristlecone pine, being 5,000 years, first took root sometime around 3,000 BC. Now, you know, when we look at the Bible, we can see a series of events, and they're laid out largely in a chronological order. Historians have you know, put the genealogies and the family trees and the series of kings and the rises and closes of empires to come up with what is that timeline. Like, it doesn't say, you know, 3000 BC, but what was the date? What's our estimate? And so while the biblical historians have reconstructed that estimate, if we use those timelines, this tree was already 1,000 years old when Moses led the people out of Egypt. And now we don't know exactly when Noah was saved by the ark during the flood, but again, based on our best estimates, historians would say that this tree probably took root shortly thereafter that the waters receded. That's how old this living tree is. This is not an old picture, it's a current picture. Can you imagine anything surviving that long, living on this earth, year after year? How many storms has that tree seen? How many sunrises? How many sunsets? How many cold nights and warm days? Over and over and over. These old bristlecone pines grow in a very specific region of the Sierra Nevada mountains of California. You know, the pine trees I have in my yard, I've got a couple different ones, and there's one that it loses its needles every 1.5 years. You know, they turn brown, they fall off. Other evergreens I have, I think, are maybe 2 to 3 years when the needles cycle themselves. Bristlecone pine needles last 25 to 30 years. A single pine cone on one of these trees takes 3 years to grow to the point where it's ready to fall off. And these trees, they don't grow tall like a redwood, they grow wide. And they grow extremely slow. Measurements would say that these trees grow about 2/10 of a millimeter per year, times 5,000 gets you a tree trunk like this. When you see a picture of these trees in this region on the mountainside, you'll notice that these trees are the only things that are growing in this area. It's a very rocky, very arid area. And if you've spent any time in the mountains or seen any pictures of the mountains, you know there's a thing called the tree line. And the tree line is the place where the trees stop and maybe there's just some grass and rocks. Because above that elevation, trees just don't grow, except for these trees. These trees actually grow above the tree line. And there's no other things around them because nothing else likes to live in this difficult, harsh climate and conditions at that elevation. I think it was the Bible that said, when thou delight thyself in the Lord, I will cause thee to ride upon the high places, places that will preserve you. Scientists have found that within this region of the Sierra Nevada mountains in California, there's a variety of these same types of trees, but the oldest of the old trees live at the highest of the high elevations. So in other words, the worse the conditions get, the longer they live. It's opposite the way we would imagine it. We'd think, well, no, give them water, give them shelter, give them everything they need. No, put them in the worst of worst places, exposed to the elements, give them the least amount of everything that they possibly need, and they will live 5,000 years. We're talking about our identity, and so the Word of God says that you shall be like a tree that can live perpetually, a tree that brings forth fruit, even though it may only be once every 3 years, a tree that has needles or leaves that last 25 to 30 years. Did you know that these trees, and trees in general, they don't relocate? They don't decide to pull up the roots and move to a more convenient place or down the mountainside to a more pleasant attitude. Their longevity is tied to their root structure, in fact. Botanists who study these ancient trees say that saplings are the most susceptible in that if a seedling makes it past the first 3 years, well, now it's got a very good likelihood or chance to survive into adulthood. I remember years ago when my daughter, she brought home one of those little saplings. It was Earth Day, I think, and she might have been kindergarten or first grade, and she was so excited that she got this little tree that we were going to plant and we're going to watch it grow. I'm like, well, you can watch it grow, but it's going to be a slow process. And honestly, in my mind, I'm thinking, yeah, this is just like the goldfish you got at the carnival. It's going to last a day, and then it's going to be right over. So with my lack of faith, I planted it kind of a foot or so off of the corner of the back of the garage, like just in a place that wasn't going to matter. It wasn't going to get in the way. Now looking back, I wish I would have planted it a little farther away from the corner of the garage, because 20 years later now, there's a huge tree there. You know, that newborn saint might not look like a strong pine yet, but give him a few years. See, God has this process that says if you'll stay planted, you will become something strong, something resilient, something that it doesn't matter what the storm that comes your way is. Luke chapter 13 compares this process to a mustard tree. It says in Luke chapter 13, verse 19, it is like a grain of mustard seed that which a man took and cast into his garden, and it grew and waxed a great tree, and the fowls of the air lodged in the branches thereof it. Have you ever sat down to watch a tree grow? Probably not. I've shared with you before that I have this little bamboo patch, a number of bamboo plants around my deck area, and those you can actually almost watch grow. In the springtime when the shoots come up, I don't actually sit there and watch them, but if I visit them every day, I can see progress on a daily basis. And to me, that's amazing that anything can grow that fast. But the growth process of being a tree is not something that you measure in minutes or days. You know, God measures it in years, 5,000 years for the bristlecone. The Bible says to be a strong tree, you have to be a worshiper, because trees worship, according to 1 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 31. Reading from 1 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 31, it says, let the heavens be glad, and let the earth rejoice, and let men Say among the nations, the Lord reigneth. Let the sea roar and the fullness thereof. Let the fields rejoice and all that therein. Verse 33, then shall the trees of the wood sing out at the presence of the Lord, because he cometh to judge the earth. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Our branches always need to be extending up like the trees, feeling after him, letting the wind pass through the branches as we start to sway back and forth as the Holy Ghost moves in our lives. Have you ever been in the woods when the wind's really strong? When the trees are really moving, they make a lot of noise. I remember one time trying to camp, and it was a windy night, and there was these trees, and honestly, I don't think I got much sleep at all because they made such racket. Trees that worship their Creator, that are constantly lifting up their branches in acknowledgement of him. There's something about being in the woods. Something unique, something special about it. Being in part of God's creation and seeing how this ecosystem just exists without mankind as God intended it to be. And in fact, there's probably a bunch of men out in the woods, even here today, right now, trying to bag a deer. And I know there's an allure of hunting, but I'm certain part of the allure is just simply the pull of wanting to be out in nature, out into a place, God's country, to be part of that, to witness it. There's something beautiful about that experience, something that doesn't happen in a suburban landscape like we live day to day. And similarly, there's something beautiful when we come together as a church, when we see all the trees assemble and start to wave their branches back and forth, something that just doesn't happen normally in day-to-day life. You know, I used to think that trees most often, and maybe you do, would die of old age, right? The tree gets old, at some point it's too old, and then it dies, and somebody comes along and cuts it down. And I've had a few dead trees I've had to take care of. My assumption was that they got old. That's what people do, right? They get old, and this life is like a vapor, the Bible says. But what I found out was that actually trees rarely die of old age. The tree is not actually designed to die of old age. It dies of other circumstances in almost every case. The number one killer of trees is either bugs or fungus. They don't die of old age. They don't age out. Something attaches itself. Some parasite enters in. And at first it's so small and insignificant it doesn't even matter. It's not visible. But over time, things get worse, and by the time you start to see signs on the outside, it may be too late to save that tree. Similarly, sin is the number one killer of trees in church. Romans 6 and 23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Did you know that even trees can backslide? Hosea chapter 14, God tells a backslidden people, "If you'll turn around, I'll make you strong trees again." Reading from Hosea chapter 14, verse 4. "I'll heal their backsliding. I will love them freely. For mine anger is turned away from them. I will be as the dew unto Israel. He shall grow as the lily and cast forth his roots as the Lebanon, a tree. His branches shall spread, and his beauty shall be as the olive tree, and his smell as the Lebanon." If you're hearing the words of God here this morning, if you're wondering, is it too late? Have I gone too far? It's not. God wants to restore your tree status. He wants to give you roots again that go deep, to allow your branches to spread, to allow the fragrance of the Holy Ghost to emanate wherever you go. This morning, if our musicians would come back, I have one last story I want to share with you. Story of a tree in my yard. And maybe you have a similar story, as it was a common story here in southeastern Wisconsin. I think it was last summer, we had to cut down one of the large trees in our yard, one of those trees that was there long before we got there. It was an ash tree, and it was plagued by the emerald ash borer beetle. In fact, as you drive through neighborhoods you over the last several years, these dead trees show up all over, and they all have the same problem. They all have this emerald-ash borer beetle that's causing them to drop all their leaves. And the tree service that came to work, to knock on my door, that worked on our trees, was actually here from Minnesota. They drove all the way here because there were so many trees that needed to be cut down. The tree services were backed out months. And so they had a really easy sales pitch. They drove through the neighborhood, they looked for dead trees, and they rang your doorbell and said, "I see you have a problem. Would you like me to fix it?" You see, there's always some sort of sign that tells there's a problem going on. Some indication that this tree isn't healthy. Luke chapter 6, verse 43, the Bible describes some symptoms of a good, a healthy tree and an unhealthy tree. Luke chapter 6, verse 43 says, "For a good tree bringeth forth not corrupt fruit, neither doth a corrupt tree bringeth forth good fruit." A healthy tree doesn't bring rotten fruit, and a rotten tree doesn't bring healthy fruit. It's either or. "For every tree is known by its own fruit. For of thorns men do not gather figs, nor bramble bush do they gather grapes." You don't go to the apple tree looking for an orange, and you don't go to the grapes looking for a plum. Every tree is known by their fruit. "A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good, and an evil man out of the evil treasure in his heart bringeth forth that which is evil, for out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaketh." As we look in the mirror, as we start to question our identity, who are we? Who are we going to be? One measurement we can apply to ourselves is to monitor our words. The things that we say, the thoughts that we think, to look on our branches for some fruit. What kind of fruit are we displaying? What kind of fruit is growing there? You know, it's not a choice to say, "Well, I'm just going to display good fruit." No, no, no. See, this is the kind of fruit that has to start from the inside and show up on the outside. And it's not a choice about displaying fruit. It's a choice about following the commandments in our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And as we take those steps of obedience, as we commune with Him, as we worship Him, as we grow our relationship with Him, the Bible says that the love of God starts to fill up this vessel. And as that love fills up this vessel, it will overflow to the point where fruit shows up. Things start to hang from the branches, not because I decided to put them on display, but because they just were there. They just grew there. It's not an overnight process. It doesn't happen in a moment, but it happens as we take steps. And every step we take in conformity to the Word of God, every step we take in obedience, every step we take closer in our relationship with Him produces something in our lives that gets put on display. Can you guess why the bristlenose pine lives so long up in the high elevation, that living even above the tree line where the rest of the trees stop? Well, scientists say it's because at that elevation, the cold temperatures kill the fungus and prevent the beetles, the bugs, that thrive at lower elevations. These ancient trees have survived, and these examples in particular, 5,000 years, because they're willing to go to the high places. And we, like a tree planted by living water, we need to not be satisfied with the lower elevations in our walk with God. Because down there, we will have to struggle with all sorts of things that want to attach themselves to us. Things that look little at the beginning that turn into something much bigger in the end. But if we'll just go up, there's a place where they can't persist. There's a place in our relationship with God where they just fall away. The Bible says we need to be like a tree that's planted in Christ Jesus, a tree that puts down roots that run deep, a tree that's patient, knowing that trees don't grow overnight. A tree that's not willing to live at a low elevation in our walk with God. God is calling us to the high places, to a place that leads to eternal life. In closing this morning, I'd like to pray for you and for me. I'd like to pray for all of us. Lord, we've been through some strange seasons. And I know that it has caused some identity crises. Some questions have entered in, Lord, some uncertainty. Who we are, who we should be, who we're gonna be. But God, as we look in the mirror, Lord, let us see the tree that's planted in you, God. Let us see something strong, something firm, something that isn't moved by situations, by storms all around us, by Lord, and if there's some questions, Lord, if there's some doubt, if there's some things that have attached themselves to us, Lord, let us find our way to some higher ground. Lord, let us reach our branches up to you again, Lord, in worship, God. Let us sing songs, Lord. Let us every day commune with you in some way, Lord, that we would, in everything we do, acknowledge you, God. Lord, and let those days accumulate to the point where someone points us, you see that one over there? That one's been, well, here for 5,000 years. A path to eternity. A tree of life planted in the middle of a garden. This time that we're in is so short in comparison to what's at stake. I pray the Lord would direct each and every one of us, that we would feel the pull of the Holy Ghost. Lord, let your conviction rest on our hearts, God, that we would take action today, Lord, that we would take a step closer today, and in the weeks and the months and the years to come, God, that we would ever go closer, never pulling back. We ask it all in the precious name this morning, the name of Jesus. May God bless every one of you.
I am forgiven. I am your friend. I am accepted. I know.